Guys, another session of the Coastal Wave podcast here with Nigel Hiranzi and
Pat Sarcone from the second floor of the Berkshire Hathaway office in Myrtle Beach. Come and check us out.
And we got another special guest today.
Very special guest, Mr. John Cassidy, and he's running for
the House District 61.
What which is House District 61?
Well, it's a brand new House District.
Well, all right. That's the county taking care of us.
And this is the state taking care of us.
All right, well.
Because one of the biggest things are to bring more money back to our county. Because as you hear, you know, from many aspects, that we're a donor state.
That's
right. Donor county.
We've talked about that before, so yeah. My statement remains true.
Yeah.
Well done. All right, John, tell us a little bit about
John, tell us about yourself.
Well, guys, I appreciate the opportunity to come out. I'm John Cassidy. Moved down to Myrtle Beach, Horry County area in 1986 to go to Coastal Carolina. And actually studied real estate. Back then, we actually had real estate was a degree that you can have in business.
I think Coastal brought that back. Didn't Marvin say something about that?
I mean, it's a little too easy to get your real estate license.
Well, it's a course.
You know, it wasn't about just a real estate license back then. I was going in for appraisals, right?
And okay, that's a little tougher.
I was going to go that direction. But towards the end of the college career, what I did is I realized that there was an opportunity that a lot of building was taking place back then. And I started gathering building permits and real estate sales. And if you remember, 1989 now, we didn't have laptops and we didn't have the internet. And we had AOL that would do the mail or their little...
It wasn't in your car.
No. John, do you remember the chat rooms on AOL?
Yeah, absolutely.
You remember that? When AOL first started, they had chat rooms.
Yeah, not in a creepy way. It was like...
There was some creepy
this is so new, like, oh my gosh, I can communicate with somebody else.
Yeah. So what happened was, man, me and my buddy Scott Creech is my business partner still. So 30 years later, we're still business partners.
Yes.
Argued, man. We respect each other. He runs the business and I'm kind of the face and the sales guy and the marketing dude.
Very good.
We've weathered a lot of storms, but what was interesting, man, back then we would do is collect the information, building permits, real estate sales, and we would have these little laptops, the Z88, they had 128K RAM, right? And we would type in all that information, we would make it legible in an Excel document, and we sold subscriptions to real estate companies, to banks, to lawyers, to building product companies. It was like a leads list, and we did that for 16 counties.
And what year was this?
This was 1990.
Wow.
And that's innovative right there.
I'm telling you. Well, you're a pioneer.
Dude, we've always stayed on that. But what happened was we, you know, young, not, we don't know everything we don't know, right? And we saw this internet thing coming and we didn't know what to do. We didn't see it as an opportunity. We saw it as a threat. We wound up selling it and it's, you guys might have heard of it now. It's called Construction Weekly.
Okay.
Right? We sold it. And since we knew the printing business a little bit, we wound up falling into printing and, you know, we started Duplicates Inc. That was 30 years ago. And, you know, dude, we've been through all kinds of things. We started downtown Conway.
So John, tell us a little bit about, Duplicates Inc. Because I've used y'all before and, a lot of our people have. Tell us a little bit about your company.
Well, we're super passionate about print as a effective communication channel. I believe it completely.
And you what all do you do?
Well, we do all types of printing from brochures and direct mail to about 7-8 years ago, we got into the sign business, you know, vehicle wraps. We do everything at Broadway at the beach, Barefoot Landing, any of that signage and things for the events, you know, at Myrtle Beach Grand Prix, all their signage, Myrtle Waves, all that stuff. We wrapped the building. The first job we ever had in the sign division of the company was a Magic Quest. Remember that down at Broadway?
Yeah,
we wrapped the entire building, dude.
Yeah.
It was crazy. So we do some really fun, innovative things, and that's what I'm proud about my team. It's like, it's not me. I'm not the successful one. We just learn to work on our business, not in it, and we got the best of the best. Everybody that works with Duplicates, we take the jobs like it's our own, and we want to make sure that they're successful. We really don't call them jobs. They're projects because we're proud of projects, right?
Awesome. So when you got into the actual wrapping of things, like how did that go? Like, you know, what was the process when you said, okay, we want to get into wrapping vehicles or buildings or, you know, was it a natural progression? You know, what was that like?
Yeah, a lot of people would think that it would be, but printing on paper is different than printing on the different substrates. There's so many different substrates for what we call in the industry wide format graphics, and what we say out in public, it's big graphics, right? So we had to find somebody that was an expert in it. And Jim Bruno came into our lives. And
Jim, I know Jim.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, he said to tell you hello.
Yeah.
Jim wow. ran
yeah.
the print division.
He worked for Burrs and Chapin.
BNC.
Yeah.
Right. And so Jim has so much experience in it. So Jim runs our sign division. And we didn't need to learn, when I say we, Scott and I, the owners, didn't need to learn how to apply the graphics. What we did is, we learned how to make sure it was profitable, right? To make sure that we were charging enough, and we weren't using too many resources, personnel resources on a project. Because, you know, personnel, there's always a weak link, and you can find the weak link in people. You know, I think one of the best quotes was a lazy person is super, super important, because they'll find the easiest way to do the hardest task, right?
True. How well said. I appreciate the heck out of that statement.
I tell you what, I feel like we have that problem with our county and our state.
Right on.
Well, the way he put that is that the lazy person finds a real easy way of doing something as a positive almost. I've never heard of that said like that.
But it's not a positive.
No, it's not a positive at all.
Positive.
But I think that's the problem with the bureaucracy.
For sure.
That we have.
The politics, or they take advantage.
And the politics, and they get into these positions, and they cannot fulfill what we need. You know, a good example is permitting in the county.
Yep, right now.
Right now. And it's just county, and I know you're going with state. But the problem with the county is right now is they can't keep up with it. And why is that?
Well, they're going to tell us that they have staffing issues.
It's always staffing issues.
I mean, that's what everyone says. So where does staffing issues start?
But if you have a businessman that understands business and understands the qualities of what you need into it, does that not make more sense?
100% more sense. That's why I'm excited to talk to you about, John. So what are you going to be able to bring to the great state of South Carolina?
I love it, man. I mean, you see me smiling so big because you guys are echoing, and we haven't even talked about this, but you're echoing exactly what I've been preaching, is that if you get a bunch of entrepreneurs in the room, when I say entrepreneurs, I mean like guys like y'all, right? We do whatever it takes to get the job done, right? I wouldn't be in 30 years in business if I wasn't an entrepreneur. There's a wantrepreneur out there, and I'm not talking bad about them. There's people that want to go into business, and they didn't realize how freaking hard it is, mm-hmm. and they bail. But then there's guys like us, been around 30 years. Man, we weathered all the storms. I'm getting to the point here, is what you get a bunch of us in a room, and I don't give a crap what that problem is. Will we fix it?
Before we leave.
How about you? How do you answer it? Would we fix it?
Well, listen, there's never a problem that we can't fix.
Boom. Right?
Ever.
Right. So with that, I'm tired of bitching and complaining about all these problems and hearing all my buddies do it. And I'm in the right time of my life. My girls have grown up. My business partner, I've been with him 32 years. He gave me his blessing. My wife, I've been with her 25 years. She gave me her blessing. And then I've had to figure out if both of them give me a blessing, something might be going on. I'm kidding about that. No, no.
Hey, John, let me stop you right there because I want to back up a minute. Tell us a little bit about your family and your history.
Thanks, man. Yeah. So, you know, did the coastal thing and got out, started the business, and then, you know, did the young guy owning his own business and being dumb and young and thinking I was on the top of the world and, you know, just had some life. Life happens. I share my stories in life. You know, I lost my parents when I was in my 20s. Mm. All my siblings passed. I had four of them by the time I was 30 from addiction.
Wow.
And it's, I've embraced loss and used loss for opportunity. Right. And I mean, because what's the other thing is like to say, hey, poor me, look at me, dude, we all got stories. Every person I've ever met's got the story. It's all the same, except it's ours personally. So, you know, I just say that I embraced it, right? So,
yeah,
you know, I went down the road, dude. And I'm this first time I'm saying it out in public since I've been a candidate is that, man, I'm an alcoholic. I've been sober for 15 years.
Congratulations. Yes.
Heck yeah, man.
And, you know, it's...
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's hard.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it. But I would never change one thing about what I did in the past because it made me who I am today.
Well said, man.
And
well
I did it because of my two daughters, Haley and Hannah, dude.
Wow.
Haley and Hannah, how old are they?
24. Haley's 24. I graduated at Wofford and then... College of Charleston with a master's in accounting. She's living in Manhattan as an accountant up there now.
Wow.
And Hannah is 22 and she's finishing up nursing up at USC.
That's wow. Awesome.
And two great kids, man. You know, when we're young.
The University of South Carolina, of course.
Yes, sir. Go Gamecocks.
Go Gamecocks.
I gotta like the Gamecocks. I gotta like the Terriers.
Yes.
And Chanticleers.
Isn't that how people pick their favorite college team, whichever school their kid goes to or where they go?
Well, yeah.
It's you know, the here and there. It's the most money.
Maybe I move around.
In the South, it's a little bit different.
And that's what I'm trying to gather.
I thought I was going to get a free shirt when Haley went to Wofford with all that money, but I didn't.
You didn't get the free shirt?
Sure. No, but.
So, John, you know, you.
And let's not forget my wife. Sorry.
No,
my
I was about to ask about that, actually.
Sean Cassidy. So you guys are too young to know Sean Cassidy, but anybody in their 40s, 40, mid-40s and up, Sean Cassidy was a heartthrob back in the 70s for women.
We in our 40s.
I know Sean Cassidy.
Well, you better not know my wife, Sean Cassidy. No. Saying it like that, dude. What's going on?
Right? I remember the show.
This was going to get real
no,
fun.
Was,
on the,
oh, no. Oh, no.
No, but you
I'm 61.
Oh, no. Yeah, you were. He was like, hey, I know Sean Cassidy. That's funny.
Oh, do I need to know Sean Cassidy?
Don't yeah. Look at him.
All I know is I know John Cassidy, and I'm sure Sean Cassidy is the best thing ever for
dude,
John.
She's a remarkable cancer survivor, had breast cancer stage 3, went through 3 surgeries, 16 chemo treatments, 38 radiation treatments, tougher than any one of us at this table.
God bless her.
And you're no kidding, man. And she put up with me for 10 years of our marriage while I was in that stage of my life.
Now, which was tougher, dealing with you or dealing with that?
It had to be me.
It had to be, right?
Yeah, man. But she's
God, listen, and all of our blessings with her.
Thanks,
and man. Her health and your children's and much love to y'all. But and you know, that's a hard battle to go through, and we have nothing but love for her.
I appreciate that. I do, man. She's a good girl. But all of them, man. We look at success when we're all.
You got all girls?
Yeah, dude. That's, oh my that's God.
That helps
that's,
you be a fighter.
That's a good Lord getting back at me.
I got two boys, and that's a good Lord getting back at me.
Oh man,
I've got 4 kids. So
you got 4 kids?
Yeah, that's a good Lord helping me.
Wow, that's a workforce.
Oh man, I guess it is. It's you got to put a lot of energy into it. I guess every investment will pay off someday.
Wow, dude, that's something, man. We stopped it. We stopped it too. We figured out what was causing it, so we put an end to it.
That was a couple
bad,
late.
Bad.
I still don't know how it happened.
I'm sorry if I took this the wrong way.
Pat didn't have that same mentality. Hey, he's from the north.
4 times. I did it 4 times.
He did it 4 times. But they all beautiful.
Oh, that's what's causing it.
Listen, he's got the Pat Jr.
I do. I got
he's,
good kids.
He's got
man.
A Pat Jr. And he is working hard.
He's a strong and working kid.
He's working with us.
He is.
He's doing a lot of projects. Things with us. And he is a strong young man.
Goes to work
and
every day.
Pat, what you don't know about Pat is Pat's, he raises his kids in a Christian school at Calvary Christian.
Yeah,
and he's actually on the board of trustees for Calvary Christian School.
I'm proud of that, too.
That's and a good I, school,
and,
man.
And I'm proud of that, too. And Pat has always instilled in me and helped me with my children when I look at it and go, you know what? And I had a Christian education coming up from Conway Christian to Calvary. Just, you know, it is a great education to give your children.
Well, education's indoctrination, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't take long to figure out if half of the stories of what we see on the news of what our kids are being taught. And that's something else that's going to have to be handled on a state level, and it's not going to go away with all what the liberals are looking for from people and whatnot. So what's your major stance as coming into South Carolina's house? What difference are you looking to make there? You know there's problems. We've got a bunch of complaining. We can't do anything about it. They've been around for years. What's the first thing you're going to do when you get there?
Well, you know, the first thing, I think it'd be really presumptuous to say I'm going to go up there and I'm going to change things, right? I'm going to be a freshman. Let's be real.
Sure.
Right. But what I, by the way, I grew up in a all-boys Catholic high school, so I know I'm with you guys on that, right? Like, right. We had brothers, not sisters, and when we messed up, they threw a desk at me. But anyway, 100% what we did is, to get back to the point, going up to Columbia, you know, I'm not going to change everything overnight, but there's some definitely key points that's super important from the constituents, and the constituents in District 61, they elect me, yes. And I represent them. I represent all of Horry County. I represent all of South Carolina. Let's not forget that, right? We need to address schooling. My personal belief, and everyone I talk to feels that we need to have less government, federal government involved in our schools.
Amen. 100%.
100%.
That's right, man. So we need to have more on parent involvement, right? If you guys on my website, not a plug for me.
Go and tell us your website.
VoteForJohnCassidy.com.
Spell that out.
VoteForJohnCassidy.com. JohnCassidy.com.
And we'll put that on our page.
Absolutely. Great.
Well, and what I would like to see, and I think that
that was a test, what, John.
How'd I do?
To see if you can spell. You get it.
Yeah. I was scared. Like,
if you would have failed that one,
we would have ended the show really quick.
No, yeah, we would have let you finish. We would have put the website up with your spelling, though.
Yeah. We would have definitely.
Yeah, my whole family would have locked the doors tonight going home.
That's great. But, I would have messed it up.
Well, what I say on there is that I would like to see more leadership skills, right? More entrepreneurship. One of the things that crushed me, man, when I went to guidance counselor with Hannah when they were, you know, her exit interview of school, she went to the, both of the girls went to the academy. What killed me was, you know, they were going, okay, what do you want to do? So the guidance counselor's doing her job, right? I'm not knocking them.
Right.
They're going, they're giving her a list of a bunch of different types of occupations. And when she got done, I go, you're missing something. And she said, well, what's that? And I said, you didn't ask her if she wanted to work for herself.
Right.
Dude, they don't teach entrepreneurship. And the reason they don't, and I'm not knocking it, is that you can't teach entrepreneurship if you're not an entrepreneur.
But you know, I believe there are certain people that are out there that can teach entrepreneurship.
I mean, we know that.
And there's people like Grant Cardone. There's many other people that teach that.
But they typically aren't working.
But our schools, they indoctrinate you to make you want to hear what you want to hear, right?
Well, yeah.
And so that has to be pulled back because, you know what, college is not for everybody, right?
No, man.
And listen, I never finished college.
I didn't finish college either.
And John,
I finished, but I was a C student, right?
I'm not saying do not finish college because I want everybody to finish.
Definitely got benefits.
It's like it definitely out benefits it, but for my career, I make a lot more money than the folks that didn't finish college.
There's a great book.
I mean, that might be bad to say, and I'm not bragging. But I'm just telling you.
Just the way you said it.
That's just, it's just, that's how it worked.
No, that's not a bragging thing, dude. I mean, it is what it is.
But you learn it.
Here's the deal is that there's a book. It's called Why A and B Students Work for C Students.
Absolutely.
Right? And it's just different, right? And to each his own.
And teachers teach, they don't do.
That's right. My wife's except my wife. She was a retired teacher. She's a retired teacher.
No, let's not knock her.
No, you're right.
She's the exception.
But they are the few. They are they should be paid a hell of a lot more because it's our leaders.
That's what I was going to say.
Oh my gosh!
Why isn't Grant Cardone working at the university?
Why are we not paying our teachers more? It's absurd to me.
It's crazy.
I would pay my nanny as much as a teacher.
Right. Right. Exactly.
Right now.
Well,
that's a job.
That's a posting. Like, think about that. That's job posting. A job posting. I would pay my nanny more than I would pay a teacher or than a teacher can make. That's sad.
Because of the amount of time that's spent with that child. right?
Well, it's just a matter of, is it a budget issue? Is it a, is it, what is the reason why teachers are paid $30,000 a year?
No, it's a greed issue.
It's a greed issue.
It's a greed issue. Not a greed like we are agree. It is greed.
It's greed.
Right? Yeah. G-R-E-E-D.
Yeah. And they're unionized. South Carolina
not,
too?
No, not South Carolina.
Most of the places.
We are not a, we don't get in South Carolina, we do not have the unions.
That's right.
Not even for the teachers?
Never. No. Okay. Never. And we're never going to do that.
I don't, well. Ever. It's up to the teachers.
No, it's not. It's up to our government.
That's right.
And it's up to our elected officials. Like when we get John elected to his office of 61, House, New District 61, for them to fight for that, because we'll never do that.
No, 100% right. You know, because, you know, with unions, then what happens is it becomes a standard across the board, right? So I'm not, I wouldn't be for that either. It should be, most jobs, in my opinion, should be not, is your pay shouldn't go up because of time served.
Well, we talk about this. So we're at the board, right? When the pay of the teachers is huge conversation the whole time.
It should be on performance.
So, but now we have performance, and so we're going to test the teachers.
But
we got to draw that out now.
The test for the teachers is how are the kids doing, not with standardized testing, but with, you know, with a different method, right?
With the grades that the teacher gives them.
So
I mean, it's tough, man. I'm telling you.
You're damn right it is,
right?
Hey,
let me tell y'all something. So I was watching, I think Ron DeSantis from Florida, the governor.
Heck yeah.
Is one of the best governors. I would love for him to run for president.
He will.
Rock and roll.
He'll wait for his turn.
He's the best. But he went in there and said, Florida's doing so much better with their kids and everything because we did not shut down the schools.
Mental health.
Do this. Mental health. Ron DeSantis has it going on.
He does. Hey, did you see what he did for the big buzzword lately? I know you guys know, is affordable housing. Did you see what he did for teachers?
I'd love to see. So what's
they
that?
Just, I think they just proposed a bill that that the state will pay the closing cost for a group of type of workers. So first responders, nurses, doctors, I don't know, doctors are in there. Teachers are one of them, right? So to help that affordable housing thing that's going on is that, so if you're a teacher, an active teacher in good standing and working, they're going to pay the closing cost on your first home.
Mm. That's something, man.
Don't we need him as a president?
We need him as a president.
I mean, he's the one paying the teachers. I got another guy that I would like to see first, but if he don't want to do it, Ron DeSantis.
Who's your first choice?
Ooh. I mean, I'll come out and say it because I'm not afraid of it. And I'll be honest with you. I'm not ever been afraid of picking my politicians. I just had a party at my house for Russell Fry running for Congress, and we trying to fry some rice. Mm-hmm. And Russell had a party. We raised him a lot of money. And I think he was 42%. Tom was 25%. We're going to be in a runoff, but we're going to beat Tom. And I love Tom. Tom's a great guy.
He made one mistake.
He made a bad mistake. But I also believe in term limits. And so term limits is something that I think that should be implemented, because you get people like Mitch McConnell and Dianne Feinstein or Nancy Pelosi, like all these people up in Washington, or back to Hugh Leatherman. Hugh Leatherman from Florence that held so much power in the Senate. Or our own Luke Rankin,
our own
I'm just gonna throw it out there on all y'all, but there has to be term limits on things, and if there's not, then how do we change things?
Well, it's because they're turning them into, they become these career politicians, you know, not so much
as a job.
It's a job, and obviously, and they make money.
And they make money.
Well, there's an end game for them, right?
Right.
Like, you know, we've seen it recently where, you know, so Ekman, me, I didn't care how much this thing paid. I didn't even know what it paid.
Sure.
Right. It's 10 grand, something like that. Right. Is that's what it pays.
Well, you got some per diems,
but it doesn't matter. It's not about the money. For me, it's not about the money, but I'm looking at why are some of these guys career politicians and start looking into it. And then you see that, all right, so they're vested and they're going to get good retirement. Well, what's good retirement on 3 years, the last 3 years of a 10,000 or 13,000, whatever it is, per year is not much. But what happens, some of them become a judge.
Okay.
Because they're appointed by who? The legislation.
I know of one that just got appointed as a judge.
And I think that you'll see that person vacate that judgeship in 3 years. Because what's the, this is just me, eh? And I'm not saying good guy, bad guy, or anything.
Great guy.
I'm just saying that, you know, I get it. He's... Dude,
wonderful guy.
The system, right?
After 3 years, he can retire from
he
that.
He could retire. Right. So let me backtrack. I don't know if he's going to retire or not, but he could, and retirement is based off of those last 3 years.
Yeah.
Right? And it is what it is, and that's the system that's set up right now. You know, I'm hearing a lot of people talk about that, is that should the legislation appoint judges, right? And that's the one that we're one of two states that do that.
Is that right?
We're one of two states that the legislation appoints most of the judges.
And you know what? They also appoint, right?
Enlighten us a few things.
So your college board of trustees.
Oh, yeah. State-funded college boards.
You're like University of South Carolina. Clemson.
Not just that. The two state-funded utilities.
Just, you know, yeah.
They appoint state those utilities. Board members.
Like, it's a lot.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like, okay. If I'm good with you, I get elected.
So I was looking into, wow. You know, why so many people into this? Like the reason I did it is because I think that this new district needs proper representation, and it needs to be from someone that's a business owner or understands business thoroughly. All right. And I'm still learning. I don't know everything, but that's why I did it. As I got into it, I started looking and finding out. This is why so many people are interested in getting in this position, because it's got some power to it. You know, you've got some, not as a freshman, but as a career politician, you're able to start appointing these people. And, you know, hell, man, human nature is what, right? They're going to do what they're going to do to get what they do. We talked about it a second ago. It's called greed.
Wow. John, tell us where your district is.
So the district is very unique. It's all of downtown Conway. And then it heads to the beach, 501, 544, and it stops at the waterway. It's everything in between there. So, Coastal Carolina, Conway Medical Center, or Georgetown Tech, you got Myrtle Trace, Burning Ridge, Legends Golf, Arrowhead. On the 544 side, you got, you know, Carolina Lakes. You got, trying to think of the other subdivision that's right there near.
There's sporadic housing all the way up 544.
Yeah, Castlewood.
Castlewood, right.
Yeah.
You've got a few. You got Palmetto Bays area. It does cut up at Forest Brook Road and cuts back over at McCormick and then back
so
down.
So it gives up Hunter's Ridge to where?
Hunter's Ridge, right, is staying in its current district, which I think is 58.
Which is Heather and Cam.
That's right.
Well, Heather.
Yeah, Heather. Right. She'll be on the show soon. Well, listen, I think we should move on past politics.
Sure.
And let's talk about more like, and we'll come back to the politics part of it.
All right.
Cool.
You know, but I just want to jump off of politics for a minute.
What you got?
Politics just gets so convoluted.
Dude, it sure does.
Right?
Yeah.
Everyone's got opinions.
And everybody's got opinions. And this podcast, we want to keep everybody in tuned. So... John, tell us about what you like to do in your personal life.
So in my personal life, it's funny, you know, when we're younger, we think of success. We all have different definitions of success. I can only talk for me, thought success was money, the house, the cars.
Okay.
And here I am 53 and I see where my girls are, dude. And you know, you guys having children, you understand this. Really, success ain't the house, ain't the money. I mean, it makes things easier.
Right.
When we look at those kids. And
money can solve some problems, but.
It's easier to deal with the problems with money. Mm-hmm. But you know, I look at those girls and, man, that's success, dude. I did the right thing. And, my wife and I, they're good, man. They're good kids.
That's so cool.
I'm street smart, right? So it's like, and my kids know that. And I have, frank conversations with them. I grew up in New Jersey,
right?
And I was the bad kid. I was the kid that I don't want my daughter bringing home, right?
That's
the truth.
I know exactly what you're talking about there.
And now we look at that. Now that's good. So personally, where do I want to go? You know, it's things change as we get older, right? As we evolve, we got different goals in mind and things like that. We want to help others. For me, now I'm in a point in my life, I want to help others.
I enjoy helping others. The reward from seeing your work be accomplished by helping someone else is more rewarding than money. Is that right?
Friggin' yeah, dude. Right? So in 2018, you know, we experienced the flood in Conway.
Sure.
Right. And this, once again, man, I ain't bragging. I'm just sharing stories.
Well, please do. Yeah. There was a nasty flood on everyone. I mean, we were in the business, so we all had properties out there that were just what was going to happen. It was pretty tough times.
We didn't know.
That's right.
We didn't know what to expect. So here we are, duplicates, my livelihood, non-flood zone. We flooded 24 inches in my building.
Yeah, there you go. Non-flood zone. Well, they sent the president down to tell us. It's you crazy. Guys are going to be okay.
Yeah, thanks. We walked in the building, and my partner and I, we looked at each other, and we're like, dude, it was 24 inches. You know, we got a $500,000 printing press there that had 24 inches of water on it. We couldn't move it. And it looked like a bomb went off. It's crazy. And what's the easiest thing to do? Bankruptcy, right? We don't have flood insurance. $250,000 worth of damage, but that's what most, I think, people would do, would be that. Man, let's file bankruptcy and wrap it up and do something else. Right. We got, at the time, I think we had 12 team members. And, you know, I said, man, there's another way we can do this. And he's like, well, I said, let's cash in our retirement. Make sure all those families, it's not the team members, the families rely on that money. Dude, money, everybody at this table, we can make it. It don't matter if we go to
zero. There's a lot of money out there.
It goes to zero, we can all make it again.
And there's never enough, and there's always more than you need, and it never comes too late, and it's just money is, there's so much. They just printed 150 trillion of it.
Yeah, I'm a printing company. I can print it. No, I'm kidding.
I mean, they literally printed $150 trillion in the last few years, so I think we're...
It's nuts. Mm-hmm. So anyway, we do that, right, in order to keep our people fed. But what I did is that what was going on, people were saying, they're going, man, on social media, I wish we could help, wish we could help, wish we could help. And I appreciate that so friggin' much, man, I do. But you couldn't go and do sandbags, and you couldn't do that, really. So I did a Facebook Live. I go, hey, man, if you guys want to help, you know what? Every business in Conway is open. I said, the best way you can help is get in your car, drive to Conway, and shop and eat and dine.
Pay the people.
And I bought software that I could build my own app.
John.
Okay.
So listen, Conway is dear and near to my heart. So I own a couple buildings down there. So when you go down the river, the building where the F.G. Burroughs boat is, that's my building.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
He saw building. Like floods and coming too.
My buddy's son repainted that. Horowitz's son, Luke. I think it was Luke.
No.
Repainted the F.G. Burroughs.
No.
Am I wrong?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, yeah. Because we commissioned that with Tommy Simpson.
Okay. Well, I've been wrong before.
But I just left to get you something.
All right.
And I want to show the people here today. I got a check right here.
Wow.
For John Cassidy. For House 61 from Nigel Horanzi that I want to give to you right now because I'm in support of this man.
Wow. Thank you.
This is yours.
I appreciate it, man. I really do. I mean, I can't tell you how humble that it, the hardest thing for guys like us is to ask for help because we're helpers.
It's hard. It's, mm-hmm. it's very hard. When Brenda Bethune was running for mayor, the hardest thing for her, which she came through my house and had a party, and said Russell Fry, is asking for money.
It's hard.
It's very hard, you know, because you got your pride behind you, and it's very hard as you get new into it, go, okay, well, I have some money, but I need to ask for money.
With politics, because if you guys don't get money, you're not going to win your races.
No.
I mean, it's a chase.
It costs to do it. Now, I can do it more efficiently than most because of the nature of my business.
Sure. Yeah, well, you don't have a big print bill.
Right. No, yeah. But
he's still got one.
Yeah, still got one.
He's still got to pay his partner.
Well, yeah, that's what we were just talking about, Nigel. We were just talking about the flood had got his building.
It did. And so thank you so much for that, man. I really, from my heart, I appreciate it because it tells me it's because you believe in me. Really.
Yeah.
And I
do.
And I will not let my folks down, man. I won't.
And I don't back people I don't believe in.
Well, I appreciate that. I do. Yeah,
100%.
So we, the flood happened and I went and bought software, right? So we're in the middle now. We
just
cashed
in your retirement to make sure your people get paid or.
And we bought a software to build an app and I built an app called We Are Conway. And I put the businesses on the app and gave like exclusive offers and stuff like that. And I told the city about it. And I said, you know, the hardest thing to ever sell anybody is your vision. Right. And so I told them I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. But most people that know me, when I tell you that John's going to do it. Promise you, it may take me a year, may take me 10 years, but I'll get that shit done. Sorry. And we got 26,000 downloads.
Really?
Wow.
300 people per day use the We Are Conway app right now.
Wow.
That's awesome.
Exclusive offers and, right, what's the name of the game in business? It's to get new customers and retain customers.
Yes.
So we put those features in the app. And the app isn't for me to make money, dude. It's to keep locals prosperous. Locals helping locals. People don't realize when you spend your money locally, you guys are familiar with the law of local magnification. They call it a couple different things, but it's if you spend your money locally, it can recirculate up to 10 times.
Wow.
Right?
Okay.
And that's important.
It's because every $100 you spend, it's going to turn $10,000 into, you know, in the community.
I'm getting ready to share something. I'm going back over to politics if it's okay. But
please.
So for years, I've worked on hundreds of campaigns with people as the marketing side of doing the direct mail and things like that. And it's always irked me, man, when you've got candidates out there that are making promises that they're going to support their local. I'm going to support my local people. I'm embedded and rooted in my community. And I'm this and I'm that. Good. Can you donate me some money? Nigel, you did. I spent 82% of my money with local vendors in Horry County.
What?
That's what you should do.
That's awesome, yeah, man.
And
that's putting your money where your mouth is again.
Well, this is all on ethics report, so you can go look at it. The opponent for 61, 85% of that money was spent with vendors outside of this market.
Wow.
That's important saying, and we're not even going to mention that name.
I'm not mentioning names. I'm just
saying.
We're
not going to mention the name of the local opponent because the only person that we need to know about today.
John Cassidy.
Is John Cassidy.
For House 61. Well,
and you got, and I'm not doing
for
that.
For House 61.
I'm saying for people to know the facts. When you go to vote, you may better damn sure that you know where your person really stands, right? And that guys, comes down to having a business mindset, right? I get it. I know I need to spend my money locally.
Yeah.
Right? Be mindful over anything
it's
like
fiduciary,
that.
Fiduciary, right? It's a fiduciary thing, man. It's like you guys just gave me money. Let's keep the freaking money here. How can I tell you? I'm sorry, I'm getting fired up.
Please do.
How can
get
I
fired
tell,
up.
How can I tell you that I'm going
we'll
I'm
call,
go
we'll
get
call
money.
This a fired up session. Go, John. Go, John.
How can I tell you I'm going to go
fired
up to Columbia
up,
and I'm going to get money for our area? I'm going to go get money for our area, guys, but I can't even spend my own the money that you donated to me. You contributed to me. I'm asking for your vote, for your money, but I go spend it up in Columbia. There you go, Columbia, and it just left. Right now, this is going to circulate in Horry County 10 times, brother. So this isn't a $1,000 donation. This is a $10,000 donation, and I appreciate that, Nigel.
How awesome is that?
Take that to the bank. Bam! Sorry.
We got you a little bit more coming though.
That's great, man. I appreciate it.
We just started.
Man.
Yeah. That's the first one.
We're rooting for you, man.
I appreciate it. Because
So tell us how you know, in a congressional race like Congress, so for Russell Fry and I don't know who his opponents are. But
I know it's Tom Rice.
I don't know who his opponents are.
It's Tom Rice.
But you got to write a personal check. But can you write company checks?
So on a congressional race, what I understand is that you got to write personal.
That's for sure.
But for
state
y'all.
Race, we're able to, the maximum is $1,000 per entity, yeah. Right? So an entity is a business, an LLC, a husband, a wife,
right?
You know, so anything with a valid social security number. Now, you know,
when you walk downstairs, we'll get you, you know, I don't know, a couple more $100.
Appreciate that, man. Really. No kidding, dude. You don't know how much.
Pat will go take care of that for us.
It's humbling. It really is, man.
Yeah.
You know, it's the belief. And now guess what? Somebody like me. Well, I can't say somebody like me. John Cassidy. I am going to work my ass off not to embarrass or somebody go, I gave him money and I shouldn't have. That will never happen.
John, I need to see the bottom of your shoes.
Oh boy, you're good. Well, you'll make fun of my shoes.
I need to see the bottom of them. Are they worn out?
I had to go buy. I wore my shoes out. I had to go buy some brand new ones. So those are brand new.
Because that's what you should do.
You check them out in 30 days, they'll be worn out.
You gotta wear the bottom of them shoes out.
Oh yeah, I'm having a huge event, man. I told you.
Where's that?
Let's hear about it,
dude. Once again, humbled, right? You know, it's amazing how your life turns around. You know, 15 years ago, I'll tell you, you know, I was drinking and doing things I shouldn't have been doing. And you think I ever thought I'd run from office? I was, heck
15
no.
years is a long time, but it's a short time, isn't it?
Yeah, man. It's a blink of an eye.
No, that's huge, though.
I made a call to David Bennett. I don't know if you guys know Coach David Bennett.
Yeah, of course. I saw that. You text that to me.
And Coach Bennett's coming down tomorrow, and we got the Peanut Warehouse in Conway, five to eight.
Wow! I sold that, by the way.
I wish I would have known.
We owned it and we sold it.
That was a good deal. The guy you sold it to, the current owners.
Mm-hmm.
Those dudes are straight up dudes. They donated that to me.
Wow!
They donated for me to use for this event because they believe people. In me.
We donated some of that riverfront to the city too,
right?
And we owned all the riverfront, and we figured as we're shutting down that company, which was called the Burroughs Company.
That's right. Yeah.
And I did the deal with the city, everything, and we figured we want to leave the city of Conway better than we found it.
Man. Well said.
We need more of that. We need more mindsets like this, right?
Yeah.
And that's a leadership mindset, yeah. Right? What have we taught our children?
Oh, we got Myrtle Beach right now that we're working on down by the pavilion.
Yeah. I saw that stuff going on.
Yeah, Chapin Company, all that. We work on all of that right now.
Who owns all those buildings right there?
We do.
Cool. Good. I love it, man. I mean, there's nothing better to have folks like you guys having forward thought of where we can take this area. There's no reason for us to be on the list that our area needs to be on. Doesn't need to be the bad list of the highest crime or human trafficking. We need to turn that crap around, guys. And
we're gonna change that. But it's gonna take some leadership. We need our city council, and eventually we're gonna have to figure out where to go from there. Our county council, which I think we're going to figure that out real soon.
That's happening now.
And then our congressional group.
Yep.
And then our congressman, which I believe will be replaced here very soon.
So what I'm hearing, make sure I'm hearing it right, I'm slow, is that we need unity.
Well, we need unity, but we need new people.
For sure. Because the old people keep doing what they keep doing.
They keep doing the same thing.
What do you get with that?
And they argue in front of us and they go to dinner later. It's getting old, man.
It's the same results. You keep doing the same thing over and over. You get the same thing over and over, right?
We're over it.
And that's great because that here's my gift. I'm not the guy that knows everything. I don't by far.
Sure.
But what I do know is a bunch of friggin' people that are smarter than I am. And when there's legislation that comes up that I don't know about, I'm not looking to the left or the right of me. I'm coming here and I'm going to say, yo, Pat, this is some legislation. How do you take this? How does it impact you?
The Nigel, people.
Nigel, what do you think about this legislation? How does it impact us?
Wow.
Right? And then we make a vote that way, not to the left or right, because
hey, who's if you
vote for,
you.
Yeah, you vote for me on this one, I'm going to vote for you. I'm not playing that stupid game. And maybe that's naive of me. Maybe I'll be blackballed and thrown out of the thing and won't get on anything.
But I'm anxious to see.
I don't give a shit because I'm going up there to do the right thing for the right people, right?
For the people that put you there, for the people, your neighbors, the people around you.
I don't think that I should go up there and vote the way I think. You guys are voting me in.
Yes.
As long as it doesn't go against 100%. My morals. Sorry.
No. I agree with you 100%. But what we need to do is get the right people in the right time. And I believe that we are finding the right people in the right times to be in the place that they need to be.
You see my post yesterday? My post. It was a post. You ever been at the right time? Not just business, right? Okay. Because we always talk about that, right? Right time, right place. That's how a lot of opportunities happen.
Sure.
Now, opportunities come in a bunch of different ways, right?
Okay.
All right, so, man, it's so hard. I'm uncomfortable getting ready to share with you, right?
Sure.
Because it's not about my about an S on my chest.
Okay.
So we're coming home from, my wife is, you guys know Florence at all?
Yes.
I'm going to drive through it.
Get my camera.
My brother-in-law owns Schofield. Ron Lyles, great guy.
Yeah,
great guy.
Restaurant.
Schofield Hardware, Ace Hardware. Oh, Ace okay, Hardware, okay, all the I'm hunters sorry. All the hunters know it, right?
Okay, I'm not familiar with it.
Yeah, out there, it's huge. It's huge. Man, awesome business, largest Ace Hardware, I think, east of the Mississippi. I mean, he does
very
good.
Cool. Okay.
He's a very, very good business guy. Anyway, my wife and his wife are twins. So okay. We're coming home from Christmas.
Identical?
No, they're not.
She's much prettier.
My wife is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Enough said.
Yeah. I got it.
I just had to mess with you on that.
Hey, test. Test two. I won.
Yeah, two going.
Yeah. So I get, we're coming home 1 o'clock in the morning, 2015. It was, because it was 1 o'clock in the morning, it was 12:26. So it was the day after Christmas. And I get Galvin's Ferry and I see a friggin', headlights travel in the same direction as I am, but they're in the other lane.
Oh, I read this story. Tell the whole story, please.
They're going towards Conway, but they're in the outbound lane.
Come on.
Dude, I'm beeping my horn like there's no one on the road, right?
But
I'm
beeping my horn. This is crazy.
And dude, the car's side by side to me. Everyone in my car is sleeping, and I see they hit head on. Another car coming from Conway, right there at the gas station.
God, be kidding me.
They immediately pull over, and, you know, both those cars kind of turn, and they almost look like they were parallel parked next to each other. Not parallel parked, but alongside of each other. And right there at the gas station, right past the gas station, that little median, right? And so I get out, and I run my family. What are you doing? I go, dude, that's what I do. I don't know about you guys, but you probably like attracts like, so I think you're like me. We don't pull our cameras out when there's a fire. We run to it. At least that's what I do.
Yep.
And who the hell can I help, man? Right? And so I go there, and a little girl's in the car that was going the wrong way, and her mother's driving. The little girl's bleeding from the head, which was cool. And I'm trying to assess what's up, right? Well, what hit her head? Does she have a neck injury? I don't have any training. I'm just going through the course, stuff.
Right?
Yeah. And I find a rag and tell the little girl, stay with, because she's in the car seat. I know she can't run or anything. Here, hold this on your head, honey. She's about 10 or so. And I get her mom out of the car. And then I come around to the other car that they hit, and I get the driver. I talk to that man, Mr. Washington, I think it was his name. I said, sir, are you all right? And he goes, yeah, my side's hurting, so I think he break a rib. I get him out of the car. I just want to get him out of the cars. And as I get him out, I'm looking over, and there's a fire starts in the car the little girl's in under the hood.
No.
So that's a concern. Concern level goes up a little bit, and I'm like just monitoring it and trying to get this gentleman out. And nobody's stopping, man. Friggin' people are going by
at 1 o'clock in the morning.
Holy crap. I'm like, I can't believe no one's stopping, but I'm doing what I got to do. And I want to keep that girl how she is because she's bleeding. I don't know if she got a neck injury, and I'm assuming the first responder is going to get there anytime. So now the cars are probably about 5 feet from each other, 4 feet or so. And I go to the passenger side of the car that's traveling the right way, and a lady has a compound fracture and blood all over the place. And she was larger, and it was hard to get her out. I was getting her out. But the flames start getting closer into the car. Guys, I can't make this shit up. This is true. And a guy stops, and I go, man, get that kid out of that car, right? And he runs over to go do it, and I'm trying to get this lady out, and it was hard to get her out, and she was pinned up, you know, from the thing, so I'm not trying to hurt her. Anyway, in my head, I'm going, man, what's taking that dude to get that kid out, right? And I look over, and his eyes are this big, and the flames are in the front of the car now, in the cabin of the car.
Oh, no.
So I leave the lady. I run back over there, and I go, what's going on? The guy goes, man, this thing's going to explode. We got to run. We got to go. I was like, I can't leave this kid, man. I mean, you know, I get it. I get it. But call me redneck. I have a little red knife on me. I pull it out. It flames, dude, are both front seats are now in flame. It's hot as shit I've ever felt in my life.
Yeah.
I cut the kid from the car. I grab her. I get about 10 feet. The car explodes. It's like Come a movie. On, man. Not like, the movie doesn't go boom. It goes whoop.
Wow.
And I was like, oh, man. So I get the girl sitting there. My wife is finally out, and I get her wrapped up. And I go back over. Now that car is fully engulfed. It's 2-3 feet from the other car. Hot as shit I've ever felt. And I get the lady out. And I get her out, and then as I'm getting her out, I see something. I'm going, man, there's somebody else is in here.
In the car that blew up?
No, the other car.
The
other car.
Right.
And there was a lady sitting in the family member in the back seat. She must have been sitting in the middle, you know, probably talking about how great the Christmas was. And when they impact, man, her head hit the windshield. You could see it, and she was slumped over that, that console. And I couldn't get her out. And then that's when the first responders got there, and that lady passed away.
Oh, man.
Mm. That's tough stuff. But
you saved a life, bro.
Dude. That
sounds like a couple.
That's amazing.
And it goes back to.
That brings a tear to your eyes.
The right time, right? It was the right friggin' time. I was there.
It was the right time for you to drive by.
Dude, I'd do it again. And I had to go to court to testify about. I won't get into details, but anyway, we had to go to court testify, and I never had to do that.
John, you are doing it again.
And
you are running into Columbia right now. It's on fire.
It's on fire,
dude,
bro.
Dude, I love that.
No.
I never thought of that.
No.
It's friggin'.
Have you ever thought about that? Like, you just ran into a fire to save somebody's life. Now you got to run to another fire to save a lot of people's lives.
I'm going.
Heck yeah.
I don't think twice.
He's got experience.
Really? No kidding.
And that's why we're having your support and your back on this, John.
I appreciate
because,
it.
Because we believe in you.
What an awesome story.
I got to meet that little girl and her dad, and we stay in touch now. I'm making sure she's going through school. She's, you know, obviously PTSD and all that, but man, she's excelling. Super excited. So the dad wrote that. A letter to somebody and said, I wish I could vote for John Cassidy because he gave me my daughter's life, dude. I'm like, I can't explain how little I feel. And that might sound weird because, dude, I'm an alcoholic.
Listen.
No, you're not.
Hey, listen, we're very humbled by what we do, and you have humbled us by what you've done. And, John, we've enjoyed having you here today. And
I thoroughly
enjoyed the conversation that we've had with you. And John, we want you to be in District 61.
Go vote for John. You just met him, the real man.
John Cassidy, he's the real man, the real deal. He cares for everybody. Y'all.
He's coming to help.
Any last words?
Hey, man, come on. You want to meet us tomorrow and see what I'm about in person?
What's your number?
Yeah, 843-602-8806. It's my cell phone, not an answer machine. I'll pick it up. If I don't, I'll call you back.
The Painted Warehouse tomorrow?
Painted Warehouse tomorrow, downtown Conway, 5 to 7.
Get out there and meet John.
5 to 8.
Guys, this is Nigel Haranzi.
Pat Zarcone with the Coastal Wave
Podcast.
Oh,
thank you for another session.
Can't wait till next time.